Brooke Hello. Shields is here.
Shields.
Hello,
hi.
Brooke.
Hello. How are you?
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Very well.
Very good.
I am here.
Thank you. Make yourself at home.
I'm going to.
Yes.
You guys have always made me at home.
Do you broadcast today?
I don't. I'm just Mondays at noon.
Oh, Mondays you do it.
Yeah, Mondays at noon.
How did it come about? I didn't know that you had any interest in doing radio.
I didn't either.
What happened?
I was approached by somebody who no longer works here. Should I put these on?
Sure. Well, if you want, just to check your
okay.
levels.
You've already outlasted the boss?
I had it fired. His first thing I said is, you know what? I'm going to change things around here because it's really broken. I need to fix it.
Anybody that would hire me can't work here.
It's clearly not good. So they brought me in and they said, well, we've got a 6-show trial. I guess that's what you do. And you sort of see if you like it and see if people respond to it and see if you can get guests. And I said, Chris, you know, my husband said, seriously, you never shut up. This is a perfect place for you.
he encouraged you to do it.
He encouraged me to do it. And I think, you know, my sort of interesting issue with it, and I was going to talk to you about it, was I love doing the interviews. The interviews to me are really fun. I like sort of because I can find not just friends, even people I don't know. I really love talking to them and making them comfortable.
Right.
But the part in the beginning where I'm just talking about myself and not necessarily having a co-pilot or a wingman or somebody to kind of bounce stuff off of. It's I'm not a stand-up comic. Like you that's what you do.
That's
so you,
right.
You know how to do it. So there's a not just because of the punchline or anything, but just starting by saying, you know what, this is what I'm thinking about. This is what's happened in my day. It feels a little self-indulgent in a weird way.
Well, it is in a way, but that's what we do. It is kind of self-indulgent.
It's weird. I have to get over that. And as much as I've been, you know, front center and the public eye or whatever, I don't crave that attention.
Well, it's weird because you're talking into a vacuum. When you do radio, you're talking like you can't tell people are driving or they're home listening. It's a weird self-conscious thing because you can't see any reaction. You can't see the eyes.
You can't read the room, you know.
Can't read the room.
Reading the room is one of the things that I've survived on to a certain extent, you know, just in anything, whether it's an event or and I kind of morph into different parts of my own personality with no matter who I'm talking to.
Picking up on the tone of what's happening.
Yeah. And I learned that early just from being interviewed from everybody. You know, Carson was going to be a different interview than Leno. And that was going to be, and then you're a different person with, you know, Fallon than you are with Barbara Walters or whatever. Like it's from the time I was a little kid, I kind of thought, oh, okay, I get how this works.
How old were you the first time you did Carson?
12.
Wow.
Do you remember who you were on with?
God, I can't remember who I was on with, but I remember the next time I did it, I was on with the Smothers Brothers and I did Karnak, but I didn't tell anybody. My mom thought it would be a good idea if I fell flat on my face on nationwide television. It's always good to do, but mom knows best. So I did it and I tripped and fell purposely just because I thought it would be funny to kind of come out really grand and, you know, this whole sort of been around in America's sweetheart sort of ridiculousness and then just fall flat on my face. I thought it was kind of funny. So they didn't know and they had me I've got a picture of Johnny with his hands reaching over the desk and his cuffs way, way, way up. And it was a really funny thing. And he goes, oh, looks like you're doing Karnak. And then thank God the Smothers Brothers said, oh, that's what you were telling me about? Because nobody believed. They all believed I really fell.
That you actually fell.
But I actually fell. The first time I went on, I was 12, and I have this very squeaky little girl voice, and it's really funny. And I also thought it would be a good idea to wear a suede dress and suede fringe boots.
Well, it's 70s, right?
It was late 70s. Yeah, it's 12, so it was late.
Suede is always good.
Yeah, suede works.
never steers you wrong.
No makeup, but short hair. It was a little scary.
You've been working in this industry for so long and have worked with so many different people that you almost don't have to talk about necessarily what's going on in your life. If you just come on the air and just tell a story of when I was doing this movie, when I worked with this guy, when I was on this Carson or Leno or whatever it is, people are so fascinated with celebrity culture that
it
would be enough, you know?
It's also, but there's also a piece that they sort of spoke to me and they said, you know, when we're kind of looking at the palette of our shows and who we have, you know, there's different niches that people sort of fill, obviously. And they love the mom part. Like, they love that I fight with my kids and that I'm, you know, take away iPads and phones and things like that. And that the feedback we keep getting is, oh, my God, I feel the same way. So it's, I'm having to find that balance between Brooke Shieldsy stuff. That's the famous part, the weird thing that's been around forever that you all sort of know and don't know why, and different manifestations of your life or my life. Like, it's been around, I've been around so long that, and yet there's this other piece that people seem to be sort of wanting to hear more of.
The relatable part.
Well, they like to hear that they're like you. Yeah, that's what it is. The average person, like a mother who's just at home, like, wow, me and Brooke have a lot in common. Like, that's because they know all the things that you don't have in common. So it's like, all right, well, she's got to deal with this shit too. It's kind of comforting.
And it is. That is the kind of thing. And it's so funny. It's not that, oh, look at me, I'm relatable. It's that I seriously deal with this shit with my kids. And my husband's away.
How old are they?
They're 10 and asshole. Yeah. No, I'm sorry. My bad. You can wait. It's radio, right? All right. I adore my kids, and my older daughter just got into the high school of her choice. Trying to get kids into high school is worse than college.
They don't just go. Like, I just went where I live.
Public school.
That's public. That's an issue too. It's sort of like in the area that we're in, the public schools are not as accessible to us. And then what do? Then you're sort of in this, you've got this kind of, well, okay, I work so that I can do this. There's a certain school that she wants to go. And it's just, but then you go through the whole thing of it, and parents are crazy, and it's like when you try to get your kid into kindergarten, it's so gross what you have to go through, and it's so hard.
Did she have to audition in a way to go and meet with them?
It's everything. You audition to a certain extent. You write essays. You have interviews. Parents have interviews. Kids and parents have interviews together.
Wow.
There's written essays. There's SSATs and ICs. It's so funny. When you have kids, you don't ever think of having to deal with this crap.
And I guess I bet if, especially if you sent them to public school, you'd have to deal with all the parents that, like, want their kids to be friends with your kids so they can get into your house and see what you're doing. And
all of that is, I mean, that's in every school. That doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
Because it's a private school, it's just maybe, you know, I don't know what I'm going to say, but like that, it's the same thing.
It is.
It's the same thing across the board. But there's also another thing, you know, I have to deal with my daughter and saying she's in that age where she also has to really believe it's all up to her, you know. And she said to me, Mom, am I going to get in somewhere just because you're my mom? And that was I never really thought I'd have to deal with that with her. And I said, the actual truth about that is it can almost be a deterrent, because people think I'm going to come with a big entourage, or it's like, there goes the neighborhood, you know, or there's going to be paparazzi, or there's going to be whatever. And I said, sometimes that's not a good thing. Like, I might be able to, you know, get you to meet a Selena Gomez because I know her publicist, but I can't. Getting into a high school, you might not really want. She resents me sometimes for being recognizable. So I've had to really fight to just keep it as conventional and quiet. As I don't like using the word normal, but like conventional and quiet in our lives, as to going through all of the motions.
When you look at that, she's probably the age you were when you started, around that age.
She's a slacker. I was already working for 13 years by the time I was 13. I modeled when I was 11 months old.
But are you amazed that, like, when you see
how young, woke up one day and I was like, Mom, I want to be in diapers.
Do you look at them like so young and go like, well, I can't believe I was in show business. Like, I'm looking from the outside at how they are at that age. Like, I was already in show business at this age.
I was already, and you know, I look at them and I get actually a little envious, especially of how confident and their pressure in their lives are things like, you know, so-and-so's asking so-and-so out, or, you know, getting into high school, or, and I had so much else on my plate at that time, and I was so insecure about it. I had to take care of my mom, and I, you know, she was kind of a wild child. I had to be on the set and have my lines memorized and have all this stuff, and that rendered me more kind of insecure, I would say, and the confidence my daughters have. And I'm nurturing this confidence, and then they have it, and they turn it right around on me. And then I'm like, really? Yeah. Really? How dare you?
Do you resent that they don't provide income?
Absolutely. Are you kidding?
You should, because, I mean,
I
you
have
know,
to
as
give
much
them money.
As much pressure as you were under, like, you're bringing some money in the house.
Well, and my mom and I, it was at that, you know, we sort of put it in a big pot. And it was like, okay, you did that movie, we get a car. You did that movie, we now get to buy our apartment. You know, so it was like this, everything had with my mother, there was no long-term plan. It was...
But you knew what your money was going to.
Meaning
that, like, you knew that, like, you weren't just going to do a movie. You knew that the household needed the money that was associated with that movie.
When you're 14, you don't give a shit. You want the money.
You kind of want the stuff.
Yeah.
It was stuff-based. It wasn't really about supporting. It was just sort of, you know, we got to go on that vacation. And, you know, it was a big deal to go on a vacation. Like, my vacations as a little kid were going across the bridge to Jersey to go to the Holiday Inn where they had an indoor pool. And that was, like, heaven to me. And then all of a sudden, a couple movies later, my mom's like, so, do you want to go to Greece? You know? Yeah. And you're just like, oh,
yeah. Is that
yeah.
in Jersey?
It's in Jersey.
You talk about your self-image. This is interesting. I knew this and didn't remember it, but you talked about when you were 22 and you lost your virginity to Dean Cain.
Superman.
Who, since reading this, is my new idol. But you said it would have occurred earlier if you had better self-image.
I think that, so in my case with regards to that, that was another tidbit that my mother decided I should put in a book, because there's no ramifications of putting in a book that you're a virgin. That'll never come back to haunt you at all.
The thing about books is they don't last.
Yeah, they don't last. People don't read.
No.
So it was... I was so disconnected from that piece of myself. And yet I was confused, because on the one hand, I was sort of America's sweetheart, virgin forever. And that was my responsibility as, like, a Catholic and as America's sweetheart. And then you've got the real just version of me and not really knowing how to reconcile that. And then sort of this whole body thing. It's like, if I'm Brooke Shields, I should probably look better. You know, that there's that weird kind of, I mean, he was just, we were together forever, and he was the most patient human I've probably ever met.
How long did you date him before it happened?
2 years.
That's patience.
That's patience.
That's patience. But that's Brooke Shields, I mean, patience. We were... Anyone else got 3 days with Dean Cain?
We loved each other, you know, we were in love. It was
right.
The pressure was so much. I don't think, you know, he probably didn't really want that on his conscience either, to a certain extent.
Yeah, your first time.
You know, it's a lot of, but I was a model, but I was never a runway model. I was only a, like, I would do the covers of magazines. The girls would get the clothes in the day. They would do the runway, and then I would photograph them at night, photographed them at night from 5 to 5 a.m. So I was never considered had the right body, because I wasn't skinny enough. I was always the athletic one. And so the clothes didn't just hang, and then we just photographed them a different way, or I was on the cover, so it was like sort of the neck up. So there was this whole part of me that I always thought, oh, I don't have a good body. That must be it, because they don't want me for runway. I'm just pretty.
So you had images about your body because they would have wanted you for runway if your body was good enough.
Right. If I was good enough, I was. So there's all these crazy things that just get put into your head as a kid, and they stay there and they grow a life. And
not realizing the fact that you're a model at all and a movie star and all this stuff puts you at, like, the top of the list.
And it's so hard to believe. And it's not, you know, it's not like this, oh, look how humble I am. It's just in that later years and, you know, being in a relationship that has, well, I mean, I've been married to Chris for 15 years. We've been together 19. And it takes that kind of person in your life to kind of help you kind of come into your own that way. And I think that that's it's just hard. That I don't think I'd survive now in this with social media.
Because there's so much more.
Mm-hmm, there's so much more access.
And you now have the ability, which you should not have the ability, to see not just what's, like, published in a magazine, but what people, like, just an average person.
What every person
is
thinks.
Is just saying.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And then also, you know, I was sort of, I had one image of being the virgin, pure America's sweetheart one. And then I had all the controversy with being, like, a sex symbol. So how do you reconcile that as a kid? You know, it's very confusing. And it's sort of, well, this was the image we put out now. And then my mom sort of said, oh, well, your fans, you've got a fan base that's really young. We need to speak to them.
Right.
So I'm all over the place.
And were they thinking, like, here's what we're going to do. This will be much less confusing. You should start hanging out with Michael Jackson.
Yeah, that'll
just bring you right back down to
Earth. Monkey.
Bubbles. Yeah.
You get bubbles to that, and it's finally all really normal.
Yeah. Were you guys supposed to be dating? Is that what it was?
Listen, we knew each other. I met him when I was 13. And I was like the person that he would call because these other famous people would sort of really like prey on him and want to be like, I'm going to sleep with him because that's going to be a thing. And we were kids together. I think that there was an arrested development to a certain extent with him in that way. But we acted like little kids together. And I don't think either one of us in our lives really had the environment to do that safely.
Did you remain friends throughout?
Throughout. He was the first person to call me when my dad got sick.
Wow.
When I had postpartum, he sent me flowers and, all of these things, even though we sort of hadn't had our regular dinners that we used to have on a more regular basis. But he was consistent to the end. And when it came time to his memorial, I had been really out of the public eye with him for a decade at least. And it was his mom who called me and said, I want you to speak.
That's
amazing. And it was because I really thought, oh, this is going to be a cartoon. I'm not going I'm not going to be invited. I never liked the dad. The dad never liked me.
Why not?
I don't know. You'll never really hear me say anything bad about anybody except for that man.
Was he as brutal? Joe Jackson, was he? They said that he took a fork and he scraped it on Michael's face when he had acne. Was he really that bad?
He's not a human being. He's the devil.
Did you see him yelling and screaming?
I didn't, but I saw the after effect. And you just look in his eyes and you kind of look back and you think, regrets. I mean, his mom was so lovely and he loved her. And you don't know, maybe certain things, people in people's lives will make them who they are. I don't know. I mean, I don't like looking at regrets, but I do feel like it was unnecessary, unkind, he wasn't kind.
Did you speak to him at the funeral or not?
I did. I had a couple cocktails. And went to the part after where everybody met, and I'd already done my speech, so I wasn't nervous anymore. And I sort of downed some whiskey, and I went over to him. I don't know what possessed me. I went over to him and I said, "You know what? You never liked me. You never even pretended to like me. I never liked you. You always were mean." And I said, "You know what? You know what I'm going to tell you? I was going to tell you, thank you." And he was like, why are you like that, Brooke? What are you doing? And I said, no, I'm going to thank you for your son. I said, because your son changed the world and was my friend. So that's what I'm going to say to you. I'm going to say thank you. And he was just like, and he was gross. He had these young women around him.
I have to go. I'm Team Joe on that one.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I get it. But I don't know why. I was like kind of was cocky and I had couple of belts in me, as my mom would say, and I didn't know what to say because I didn't want at Michael's memorial to be toxic.
And you didn't want to be fake though, and just go,
and I didn't
want
to be fake, like, I'm so sorry for your loss. Bullshit. I didn't feel bad at all.
Did Michael hate him?
I don't think you can truly deeply hate your parent because you get one of them. I think he was so hurt by him, and I think he was in absolute disbelief. Michael didn't have hate. I think he just couldn't believe it. He couldn't believe how mean it was to him. You know?
How do your kids reconcile the fact that you had that relationship? Because like my dad had like two or three conversations with Andy Warhol, and I feel like every month or so, I end up asking him about them again, just because, like, that's just to me one of those fascinating entities that, like, doesn't even exist as a person.
Your dad and Andy had a lot in common.
What's my dad didn't paint.
No, I know he didn't.
My kids don't really. I've just recently, I'm working with Calvin Klein again, and Raph Simmons is their new creative director, and he brought me back in with this sort of an homage to the old images that became so sort of iconic in the time. And my daughter was more interested. I told her I was going to a show and I got hair and makeup, and she looked at me, she goes, "You're looking good these days. Like, you should do this Calvin Klein stuff more often." And I was like, that's what the takeaway is? I was like, do you look at the picture? And she's like, "Yeah, that was a long time ago, Mom." I was like, I'm not going to get the kind of respect that I want from you.
There's no sort of reverence to...
No. But if I do, but when Gigi Hadid gave me the nod and wanted to take a photograph of me for V Magazine, and I called her and I took a picture with Gigi, and I was like, see, I'm cool. That blew her mind, and all of a sudden.
There's no like, holy shit, my mom was like best friends with the biggest, arguably most important pop star of all time.
You know, it just doesn't occur. I mean, maybe when they're older and I, you know, try to have stuff on a loop in their dorm room, yeah. All my old stuff.
Yeah. Well, they're used to it, too. Plus, they grew up with it. They grew up seeing pictures of you and Michael in the house, so it's not surprise. It's like they're just one of Mom's friends.
Plus, it's not... the world that I lived in the 80s really doesn't... It only kind of comes in a retro kind of a way, you know? When I go to the New York Academy of Art, right, where I'm on the board, and, you know, that was partially started by Warhol. So, you know, the fact that I have Andy's, you know, signing an interview magazine of Deborah Harry because he knew what a fan I was of hers. Like, it's there's that stuff, but it doesn't, I don't live it on a daily basis, and I'm not bringing them front row to the Grammys or anything like that. So it's a very compartmentalized life, oddly.
Was there a point where you said front row of the Grammy? Was there a point where you're doing all this stuff, you're Brooke Shields, you can have access to anywhere? Was there a point where it slowed down and you're like, oh, I can't get into that at this point now? Was there a moment where you were like, oh, wait a minute, they're not giving me the respect they gave me 2 years ago?
Oh, you know, the word respect is probably a whole other show, because I don't know if that's the right word, but...
Or the access.
The props or the whatever. Yeah. Not even props, no. Right after I graduated from college, so I went away 4 years, and I came out, and they were sort of like, yeah, no, there's a whole other crop of people, and you're like 20 pounds heavier, and you kind of... I was like, but I'm smart.
I'm educated. Right.
I'm educated. Don't do it. Now I'm an educated actress. Isn't that what we all want? And they were like, no.
Yeah.
No, thank you. And then it became, talk about pressure of money. So then we had this sort of empire. We had a house in New Jersey. We had a house in New York. And we had a house in Montana. And my mom would buy these houses because we were going to all go live like Bruce Weber in Montana and have Thanksgiving dinners, and we lived these fantasies. We never moved into any of the houses. So I had to pay these things off. And then, you know, my mom's going, okay, we're going to do a Nescafe commercial in Paris, but it's for an Italian company, but we're going to do it in Paris, but you're going to do it in English, and then they're going to subtitle you and W. And it was like, what happened to my career? Like, I worked with Zeffirelli and Louis Malle, and now I'm doing like Nescafe commercials in Paris, and she's getting drunk, and I'm a weird version of Brooke Shields. Like, it was such a dark, like, 10 years.
Your mom was getting drunk.
I mean, since the day I was born, but you know what I mean? It was this, I sort of looked at my life thinking, this doesn't feel at all the same, plus I'm not being able to be creative. At least prior, it was a spectacle, but I got to be creative, you know, in the commercials for Calvin Klein. I got to act different characters. I got to memorize lines. I in the movies that I made prior to college, I had a talent that was being nurtured.
And it sounds, too, like instead of what you said before, where the first run was about getting cool things and vacations and stuff, now it's like, I need the work.
I need the work, and I didn't realize how much I needed it creatively. And I got really dark after college, you know, and I sort of went into that, I'm going to take acting classes and I'm going to be miserable and I'm going to write. And I did that sort of version of angst. And that didn't even help, because then I would still be Brooke Shields and they would say, well, you're too famous. We don't want you to audition for this because we want to find unknowns. So then I didn't have the coolness of being that name. I didn't have the history of being recently in films that did really well. There was another crop of people. Education had nothing to do with it. And so I was really sort of relegated to things that just my mom would say, well, work generates work. We just have to keep your name out there. And, you know, it became a money thing.
Sorry, but who was the main one that you felt replaced you, like the new crop? Who is the name that they're like, oh, no, we have so-and-so and not Brooke?
There wasn't just one person. It became then, oh, Jody went to college. I went to college. Like Phoebe Cates went to college. There were some like actresses. But it was the child star just had sort of gone away. Now they were finding new people. And they weren't designating a new person to the same extent. You know, or I did this movie called Freeway with Reese Witherspoon. And I was sort of brought in as the name, you know, the sort of the whatever that was. And she was like the kid that was becoming, you know, just starting in the business. And it was so unbelievable to me because the film got into the Sundance Film Festival. And I distinctly remember her publicist not letting her pose in pictures with me.
Wow.
And I was so obliterated. I was so crushed because this whole sort of new crop of younger people, it was not cool. You know, I was considered a celebrity and a famous person, but I wasn't an actress anymore.
Did you A, discuss this with Reese, and B, did you ever tell the publicist to go fuck herself or himself?
No, didn't have the guts to do anything of the sort at that time. And just pulled myself out and started going down this slope of really even deeper insecurity. And then my publicist was sort of saying, well, forget her. Then we're not doing, you know, then but you just, you know. Nobody gets it. I mean, she was trying to build me up.
Sure.
But no matter how built up personally you get, it's not professionally advancing you at all if then you don't get to sit next to the person who they didn't know she was going to become a huge star. But you never know that. You never know when anybody who's going to kind of hit. But I remember that starting to be, I thought, wow, this is a really scary period of time. And it wasn't until Broadway came to me to ask me to replace Rosie O'Donnell, which usually think of the two of us in the same category.
Yes, women who are not going to sleep with me.
Oh. I got nothing.
Reasons.
I got nothing there, yeah. Right? Nothing.
Because it's true, but go on.
He speaks the truth.
Yeah, Rosie we've established a long time ago. Yeah.
But I replaced her on Broadway, and then friends called the show and asked if I'd come on the Super Bowl episode.
Were you okay doing that?
I
being on Friends after the Super Bowl, was that okay with you?
It was I said yes without seeing the script. Right. I was such a fan of the show that I was just like, yes, let me check my schedule, yes.
Wait, what did you replace her on?
I didn't replace anybody. I was in the... Oh, Grease was for Rosie and I. Rosie originated Grease on Broadway.
Okay.
She was Rizzo. And then I went in and played Rizzo.
Okay.
On Friends, I played a crazy stalker fan of Joey's.
Which was the biggest show in the world at the time.
Yeah. The biggest show in the world. And, you know, Thursday night, and as I was on that show, and I was allowed to do what I wanted, they tried to not let me do certain comedic things that I wanted to do. I had to take their direction. And then we always do a second pass in sitcoms and in that multicam. And one of the creators of the show screamed across the stage and said, Shields, put it back in. And I got to put something back in that they had taken out in rehearsal because they said, if I act too crazy, it won't be believable. I'm like, okay, we're doing Friends. And she let me put it back in. And it was one of those moments that I'll never forget because it changed the trajectory of my career.
What was the moment?
It was I lick Joey's fingers and then I laugh maniacally. And I'm really in a sexy outfit and the hair and the makeup. And I'm a crazy person. And they just wanted me to sort of be more subtle and not as funny and not as kind of crazy. And they put it back in. And by the end of the evening, all the executives had come down to the stage and began talking. And the next day they asked me if I wanted to ever have my own show.
Wow,
and
so
that stuff doesn't happen Susan. Anymore. And then suddenly
wow.
Susan, they found
that weird moment
Susan.
that where the director yells
I thought there was a person in the studio here who I thought a mouth was agape with like, wow, that's how it happened. He was yawning.
No.
He literally was just, he was like,
D-bag. Oh, D-Bag's young. D-bag. He's going, what's a sitcom?
Really?
Right?
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
Big deal.
I don't know.
D-Bag, he just yawns when.
Sorry.
Yeah. No, he should be apologizing.
He's got his Seinfeld shirt on. He's like, well, it wasn't Seinfeld.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I was never on Seinfeld. I was sorry.
Isn't it weird, though, that that's what does it, and that's what I think, I mean, you hear more stories about that than anything else. It's these weird little seemingly mundane moments that you can never plan for that just have to happen at the right moment with the right people around seeing, and all of a sudden this thing that you didn't wake up in the morning thinking I'm going to do that becomes this piece that is the trajectory to whatever your next step is.
And I think that it's that piece that you have to keep remembering, because it's being open almost all the time to a certain extent with what's going to, because I always said, oh, I don't have a plan. I need a plan. And it's also, I never experienced nepotism like that. I didn't know the director, and then that person gave this to me. And so I sort of grew up with just work generates work. You just got to keep saying yes to it, which is also not always the best thing to do. I think you have to learn to be a little bit pickier. But in this time and case, there was something else at play, and the timing was right. I don't know if that happens anymore. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's, you know, the Lana Turner at the you know, soda fountain kind of thing.
Right,
she gets discovered by whoever. I needed to be discovered again, but I was already ridiculously famous. So that was the hard piece. But no one had ever seen me be funny.
Right.
And so I was like, oh, you can look that way and be funny. Brooke Shields is funny. Like, that became the thing.
Yeah.
Remember Patrice used to say, the next thing is Brooke Shields is mean?
Yeah. He wanted to do a show.
He wanted
to Brooke Shields
is
mean.
And I was like, write it, Patrice. I will do the show.
That's what he wanted the show to be called?
He loved Brooke. We did that film together. And
Furry Vengeance, right?
Yeah. And, you know, it wasn't...
had fun.
Yeah, it was fun.
I liked it.
And
it wasn't that catalyst moment for Jim that he thought it might be. That it
was one of us.
His friend's moment. Who's this
but
Jim?
He was
they
sweet.
Said, yeah, we need a construction worker who talks around talking animals. If that ever comes up again, I'll be there. But Patrice genuinely liked Brooke a lot. And
I mean, and people know that's not a statement that you can just make in passing. Like, Patrice liked very few people.
Yeah.
Really? And I didn't.
Especially women.
Yeah, especially.
And I didn't like go in and say, this is a guy I'm gonna get him on my side. It happened, and then we kind of went with it. But it was genuine from both of us. And it was a very unlikely friendship.
Yeah. Yeah. And he wanted to do a show called Brooke Shields is Mean, because she would just say weird shit to people and funny shit to people.
Like what?
Like, she commented, there's a picture of us where I'm facing one way and she's facing like E.T. mocking my posture. But you had said that to me, Jenny. What did you say to me first?
At first I was like, you know, that's amazing. You are, like, nobody really knows what a good actor you are. Is that true? Like, I know you're a comic and all this, but you're a really good actor. Like, that choice that you made for that character is amazing. He's like, I had scoliosis as a kid. I was like, and Patrice was like, you're so mean.
The way I was standing, she thought it was like character choice.
A construction worker that had worn, and his back was bad,
I was like,
and he's hunched
over. Yeah, that's really, like, he's physicalizing it. And then I told you that when you said, we're talking about Nancy Reagan and being skinny. And I said her head was too big for her body. And you were like, are you seriously just said that? And Patrice was like, I'm telling you, this girl is mean. I was like, I'm not mean. I say stuff before I think about it.
It was great. Yeah, he loved that about you. That was it was really genuine. It was really funny. I didn't have scoliosis. I think I was just trying to.
I know. But that was, you had a better comeback, clearly, because you're a comic.
My uncomfortable humiliation of being slumped over in front of the most famous model alive.
And I was giving him all these props. And then when we had to learn that dance, and I had to teach it to Patrice. And
you
he looked at me.
You had to teach Patrice how to dance?
I had to. He goes, there's something really wrong with this. I was like, hey, I don't know what to tell you. You're not doing the step right, and you got to do it right, because we all have to do it on camera. And then he was sort of like, all right, so what is this? And it was a really kind of weird, funny, funky, rappy.
Insane in the Membrane, I think, was the
insane
song.
In the Membrane.
But that he would even do it.
I posted video of, it was a rehearsal. It was not
in
the
that
actual,
little room up at the top of the room.
Yes, where the guy was trying to show us, and Patrice was so bad at it, and on purpose, and too cool to do
it. He was so mad.
But it's like, you're going to do it, stupid. You're here. You're
going
to do it.
Right, you're not going home.
No, you're not leaving.
But when he saw me really, really rehearse it, I think he kind of, he sort of said, okay, then I'm, I don't know, like, he saw me work really hard at it, and I wasn't making fun of it. And I even said to him, I go, don't make fun of it. It just makes you an asshole. I was like, you're doing the movie. Like, don't be the jerk that then is like, I'm not going to do this, or I'm staying in my dressing room. Like, it was dumb. It was kind of crazy and dumb.
Who was the guy that played the kid?
Oh, the kid, Josh.
Let me see his face. Do you remember him?
Trying to remember. His name is Josh.
Is he still acting, or...
I know he was doing some things, but I don't know if I can't remember. He then started dating the girl that played my daughter in Lipstick Jungle. That's what I remember.
Wow.
I don't know what that
I've
means.
Never dated a famous person. I think I should.
I think you should too.
If you have any friends.
I will. I'm going to comb.
Like what
comb
level
my,
of fame?
My Rolodex.
I know this guy, Jim Norton. What level of fame do you think?
Any level of fame would be fine. I mean, I'm not looking
like
for
Snooki?
Do you have a type?
Type?
that was a setup, I'm sure. I'm glad you're answering me honestly.
Believe me, I'm erasing things. I would say just somebody who might be...
Laverne Cox?
Somewhat, from years ago. Somebody, you know, the original version of Laverne Cox.
Caitlin?
No, not Caitlin. I'm an ageist. I would say...
Caitlin's too old.
I would say somebody famous and delightful and fun. I've never seen the end of this.
Oh, you've never seen it?
No.
Oh, yeah, I had to learn that whole thing. Look at the Blue Lagoon homage.
Oh, my God.
How hysterical is that?
Wow. He looks fat, too, Brendan Fraser.
He kept doing that, though. He kept puffing his stomach out and being really, really gross. All the outtakes were super funny.
Ken Jeong was in that?
Ken Jeong was in that.
Oh, Ken Jeong, wow.
Yeah, it really was a good group of people that we sort of got together. Yeah. I thought it was really fun. There you are, the construction. There's Patrice. There's dancing.
Not doing anything. Patrice wasn't doing a thing.
Oh my God. Yeah. It was
a Bollywood ending almost.
It was a Bollywood ending.
Look at Patrice not dancing.
Look at Patrice not dancing. But he was doing something.
He was stepping.
Yep.
He's not happy at all. And I was hiding behind that guy.
He keeps looking around. Like,
where are you? Oh, is that you in the blue?
I was so embarrassed. I was hiding. Yeah.
Were you clapping a little bit while you
danced? I was doing what you're supposed to do. I did the dance. I hated it. And I was embarrassed.
Oh, look at him clapping. Look at little Jimmy clapping.
Yeah.
Oh, and who's right after? Yeah, that's where we're.
Little Jimmy really is insane in the Membrane.
I really am. People have said that, and I just didn't want it to come out musically. I'm really bad.
You're a bad dancer?
Yeah. Can I go back to the beginning for what we talked about before? We talked about Dean Cain briefly. I just wanted to ask, after that first experience, was it what you wanted, or was it like, oh my God, I shouldn't have?
I like a crazy person, I ran down the hall. I ran away. I ran butt naked down the hall. He had to run after me and cover me with a blanket and be like, I don't know, you're panicking, and this is okay. You're okay. I was like, the world's going to know. My mom's downstairs. She's passed out, but she's going to know. This is all weird. This is not what... And
where was
it? It was a disaster, Sun Valley, Idaho.
But in his house or whatever?
In my house.
In your house.
Oh, okay, did you feel like you had held on to virginity for so long, and I blew it, it's done. Yeah, I can never regain that.
I can't do it, and then I'm a liar. And then now do I have to tell everybody when it happened? Like,
right.
I told them I was, so now do I have to write another book? And it was just so convoluted and a shame. Like, it's, you know, Dino and I are still friends and really good friends. I mean, and it was an interesting thing because I felt, I mean, obviously it wasn't his first time, but you know, I felt bad about that. Like, and then I've got daughters now, and you don't want to sort of say, do yourself a favor, be a slut. Do yourself a favor.
It's going
to serve you much better. And you don't want to do that. And I'm, you know, you're glad you wait, because it was the right, but it was like, it was the right person. It was the right, it was a little later probably than
you're 22, right?
22. Yeah. Right, but there was nothing traumatically bad. You know, it wasn't, I mean, now these kids talk about doing it as a pact.
Yeah.
You know, they make dates to it for it. It's like, I mean, I've got two daughters. What do you say to them? How do you tell them that because I'm not going to be the one that says, oh, I waited till I was 22 and you should, because no, I don't.
Because you thought it messed you up a little bit by waiting so
long. I think it
so
messed
long.
Me up a lot. And I also think it was, it didn't have to be that fraught.
When you, after it happened, how long did it take you to actually get comfortable with, like, all right, I'm a sexual person now. This is
well,
who I am.
It was one of those. It was like, at first, it was one of those things where it was like, you know, you're on a diet and then you eat a piece of cake. You're like, fuck it, I'm gonna eat the whole cake.
Sure.
In a weird way, yeah. I was like, well, I'm already damaged goods. Like, I mean, you get Catholic on this and a whole country. It was really, really. It took a while. It took actually breaking up with Dean. And then getting back together with him. That sort of like, then I was trying to kind of regain all of it, you know? But I had a few years there where I was not very discerning.
Were you eating a lot of cake?
So to speak.
Yeah, cool. Awesome.
That's what the kid's calling it today. Let's eat that cake.
Risk of diabetes.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Absolutely. I would be down to two toes if that was true.
That's why those Jonas Brothers are so smart. They were in purity rings, and then one day, no more rings.
Done.
You don't need to explain it. You don't need to
write
a book.
Tell anybody about it.
Just no rings.
No rings.
Guess what happened?
Guess what?
And did you? And I'm, again, there was an article in the Times where your mom was pregnant. Did the boyfriend of your mom, who's your dad,
right,
really offer your mom and want her to terminate the pregnancy and offer her money?
Yeah, I wrote about it in my book. My grandfather sat my mom down and kind of slid an envelope, you know, across the table, and because my dad was on the social register, like in the blue book or whatever it is in New York, that you're on a social something. And I got taken off the social register after Pretty Baby because I was in controversial movies, so I wasn't good for the community.
Right.
Oh.
And I thought it was kind of cool to get taken off the social register. It was like that was as edgy as I'd ever been. But yeah, they didn't want him to marry a woman from Newark, and they didn't want him to have a kid out of wedlock.
Wow. And how much did he offer? Do you know?
I don't know, but she bought a table.
Oh, she took the money?
She took it, yeah.
Oh, good for her.
She's like, I go, Mom, what'd you do? She's like, I'm not an idiot. She said, I took the money, Brooke, and I went and bought a table.
That's great.
That table is a coffee table that was given to my godmother. My godmother gave it away to another person. I tried to get it back over the years. My book came out. This woman found me and gave me the table back. I own the table that I owe my life to.
That's amazing.
That's amazing.
It's like,
wow.
Should have given birth on the table.
I know. That would have been eBay.
I love Mom. She bought the table and kicked her pregnant feet up on it. Good for her.
Yeah, exactly.
That's great.
Yeah. My mom was like, I don't think you got to meet her, but she would have, like, Patrice would have loved my mom, and go figure. And you would have loved her. Like, she had balls. Like, she was.
When did she die?
She died in 2012.
Okay.
And it was, she did not die in a very ballsy way. She did not die with any of her, you know. Red lips or you know, that. I mean, this is a woman who, this is also in my book, had a boyfriend, and the boyfriend was at a bar with another woman. The bartender calls my mom and says, hey, Terry, you know, your guy's here with another dame. And she's like, really? Thank you. She gets dressed with her coat and her high heels, a coat that he had given her for a coat, just the coat and the high heels. That's it. She goes to the restaurant, walks to their table, stands in front of the woman, looks right at the woman, and says to the guy, his name, honey, do you like my fur coat? She opens it up, butt naked underneath, turns around, and walks back out. That was the way she told him she knew he was cheating on her. And that's a woman who just flashed this other woman and then walks out of the... And then, you know, maybe she cried for the rest
sure.
of the night and on the street and
but she
got hammered,
moment.
But she got her moment. Like,
but
that
she
was,
ruined that dinner.
Oh,
she
yeah.
ruined that dinner. She was like a, she blew up things. Like, that's what my mom
scorched
did.
Earth
she
policy.
Would just go, yeah, she would just, she'd just torch it.
And how do you feel about your dad's family?
I'm on my way there and after this interview to spend the weekend bringing my kids to see my stepmom. My dad died 6 weeks before my 3 weeks, actually, wow, before my first daughter was born. And we've all rallied around my stepmom. I've got half-sisters. My stepsister lives with me. So we've
wow.
just kind of maintained that. I mean, the irony is I was the black sheep. Like, I didn't have the right clothes. My dad would buy me a Lacoste shirt. My mom would painstakingly take off the friggin' little alligator, which is not easy to do. So I was the kid that would go to the club, but that had holes in the shirt because my mom didn't want me to wear the status symbol. It was all really confusing and weird. But we have Christmas dinner at my house every year. My three half-sisters and my stepmom, they've all sort of rallied around, and she allowed her firstborn daughter, my stepsister, to travel everywhere with my mother and me, which was very unconventional.
But the grandfather, your dad's dad, who offered that money, mm-hmm. What kind of relationship did you have with him?
He died when I was very young. I was like 3.
Oh, okay. So,
I never knew. And you know what? The irony in that is he was from Brooklyn. He was the wrong side of the tracks. Like, he was a bad boy tennis player that just married wealthy women. Like, he married all these unbelievable socialite women. And then here he is trying to say to my mom, like, you know, we get this. Like, you and I, we speak the same language. So can you get lost, please? And let's get rid of the, you know, he can date you for a little while, but you can't have a baby.
Isn't that amazing? And he never saw what you became. Like, it's like funny. Like, 3 years old, he dies, and he has no idea, like, where you are in your life. And
he was the number one tennis player in the world. And he was the head of the Davis Cup. And he was sort of this. He also was under contract at Paramount when he was in movies like Come and Get It with Francis Farmer. Like, he was this handsome man who was this sort of bad boy on the defaulted at the French Open because he woke up on some beautiful woman's yacht in the middle of the French Riviera. Like,
he was McEnroe before McEnroe.
He was McEnroe before McEnroe. But he was, like, even more self-destructive, like this man.
Did he ruin his tennis career?
No. He kept getting all the trophies. He was head of, number one in the world and Davis Cup, and then he was sort of a movie star. So nothing got ruined because he just went to the next thing and then, then died.
Sounds like you got a lot to talk about on your radio show.
I guess so.
Well, that's why you do a good radio show.
It's the question and answer thing that I love. People ask me questions, and then I can run with it. But it's sort of,
right,
did I tell you about my grandfather?
Nobody asked you, Brooke. You're like, yes. Yeah. Jim did. Sam asked me. Yeah, they asked me.
But it's also fun to talk to people. Like, when you interview people, and we've learned this over the years, the one thing you hate is somebody who won't give information.
Yeah.
So if ever I'm asked questions, I try to answer everything. Because when people are like, well, I don't really want this. Like, don't you understand that's a part of... So
it's the point.
Yeah.
Well, it's like, it's like Patrice not wanting to dance. It's like, then don't say yes to the interview.
Yeah.
I do think, you can't... I was talking to Andy Cohen because he came on, and I said, at what point is access too much? Like, at what point do you... I'm able to draw the line with not bringing my children into certain things.
Sure.
They all want my kids on, and they want my kids in shows, and and that's my version of keeping my private life as private.
Right.
But as far as things that are just concerning me, I'm not afraid to be honest because it's the truth.
Right, and there's nothing to lose.
There's nothing to lose, and then nobody can. There's no discussion anymore about it.
And people love that about famous people when they're open. Like, that's all you ask sometimes, is not to give the right answer to the just someone who's open and answers the question. And you'd be surprised how many people don't. And I guess we've encountered it because we don't have the level that you do of trust or fame. But you ask people questions, and they're like, "Well, I don't want." And it's like, I don't know why you're embarrassed to answer that. It's not a big deal.
And it's not. And you've made it a bigger deal by hemming and hawing and kind of all of a sudden now putting this thing around it,
When is we have 2 minutes till the end of the show. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, we got to take
Chris
a break
is right.
And come back.
Do we?
Otherwise we have 4 breaks.
Okay, let's just, when is your show on? Mondays?
Mondays at noon.
What channel?
109.
Okay,
Now.
Right. 109.
So check it out. Mondays at noon on SiriusXM channel 109. Thank you, Brooke Shields.
We'll be right back.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back.
Bye.